for the kind introduction, and thank you all for being here today. What I'd like to take you here is through a really eye-opening experience. That's what it was for me. I started my career being inspired by great footballers and being inspired by science. And I decided to go into the area of biomechanics and study motion. About 20 years ago, I was recruited by Nike to head research in the area of football. This is where I was working. This is what I was doing. And perhaps one of the greatest experiences that I had was the opportunity to give players, young players, academy players, what I did not have as a player, as a young, developing, never developed to any kind of a player, but as a young, inspired athlete. What we did as a group, we were able to develop an app that was called Master Control, with the best coaches in the world, that every young athlete, young player, could learn how they train in Barcelona, how they train in the Brazil national team. The players that were introduced and they were demonstrating those training programs were 17-year-old Sergio Roberto, 17-year-old Felipe Coutinho, and others. But what we were hearing more and more is that the game is becoming faster and faster. And now we even have the statistics to tell that. This is the number of actions or the number of passes per game for the top 10 passing teams in the EPL over the last 10 years. And what we see, there is a 25% increase in the number of actions per team per game, which means the time you have to make a decision is smaller, got significantly smaller. What can we do about it? The area that I'd like to present to you is the fifth element, or the cognitive area that starts from game vision. How well or how fast can you see? How quickly do you think? And how fast do you react? And let me take you through the process. The process involved lab assessment, which takes about 30 minutes, and field training. So the combination or the concept is test in the lab, work in the field, because on the field you can gain the element of specificity and get the athletes doing their actions as they do it during the game. Let's start with the lab assessment. What we assess in the lab are 10 different visual skills, and those skills are skills that players can develop. It used to be, and we hear it from less modern coaches, well, game intelligence and game vision is something that you're either born with or not. Not true. Well, partially true. You are born with it or not, but you can also develop it. In the lab, we assess visual clarity. Actually, visual clarity is perhaps the only thing that clubs are assessing today. Then, contrast sensitivity, the ability to differentiate between contrasts. Depth perception, the ability to read distance, near-far quickness. How quickly can your eyes focus from far targets to near targets? Peripheral vision, which is critical for football. Perception span. How many targets can you see when you raise your head? So Don was a footballer, a very good one. I was not. We can both dribble. We can both have the exact same visual clarity, 6-6. But when he raises his head for a split second, he might see 8 targets. I might see only 2. That affects my decision. Eye-hand coordination we test in the lab. Go-no-go, which is decision-making. Eye reaction time. How quickly can you react to a visual stimulus, and hand reaction time. In a nutshell, what we're interested in is to know critical questions. How fast do you see? How much do you see? And how wide do you see? So if the only thing that you're taking from my talk today is that vision is not only how clear do you see, But vision in football is also how much do you see, how quickly do you see, and how wide do you see. I've done my job. The results are shown here. And I think one of the beauties of the system that we've been working with, I've been working with for the last 8 years, starting at Nike for 3 years and then on my own for 5 years, is that we have an extensive database of 4,000 players from different sports. It's global, it's sport specific, it's age specific, it's position specific. The scores are relative. So if a footballer is tested, he's tested against, if an academy player is tested, he's tested relative to academy players. You can identify strengths and weaknesses, and you can develop training programs accordingly. Then on the field, we train with stroboscopic glasses. Basically, they blink. There are 24 conditions. The story of the strobe actually started from a player, a basketball player that you might know, Michael Jordan. And in the 90s, he asked his trainer, Timmy Grover, to help him shoot better when all the flashes were coming in the stadium. So Timmy was bringing disco lights, and Michael was shooting with disco lights. Eventually he said, that's great when we train in Chicago, what are we gonna do when we train on the road? So they built a prototype of the strobe. Now the strobe is available by a number of companies. And this is the tool that we can bring to the field to train eye reaction time, to train peripheral vision. What I found very interestingly, which I'm sure you found the same thing, is the gap between technology and clubs. So I spent my time over the last 5 years trying to bridge that gap. How can this technology be implemented? What are the correct training programs? What is the frequency? How do we use the analysis from the lab to help them train on the field? And how to help team staff to continue to carry those benefits when I'm not there? And what that takes us is to the one element that I spent my last 5 years on, transferability. How can we transfer technology from theory to practice? So let's ask real questions about transferability. The first question is, can lab scores predict skills performance? In this case, we have two graphs in martial arts. When athletes came to the lab, got tested, then went to their areas, conducted a skill that is very critical for martial arts. And what we see here, for example, that the better their eye reaction time was, the faster they completed the task. So we've seen a correlation between lab scores and skill scores. Second, can lab results predict game performance? Oh, sorry. If there is a correlation between skills and lab scores, that helps, especially in academy players. That has great implications for the selection of talent, not only based on their physical performance and their physical build. The second is, can lab scores predict game performance? This is a study by Poltavsky and Biberdorf that demonstrated a correlation between decision-making scores in the lab, the go-no-go test, and conversion of chances during the game in collegiate ice hockey. So there is a correlation there. Next question is, can we improve visual skills? If I ask you, can coaches or trainers develop speed, agility, power, endurance, you'd say, of course. But can we develop eye reaction time, peripheral vision, anticipation? Let me show you how. Can you play the video, please? Here are a series of drills of both academy players and top 10 tennis players. With the strokes, so they don't get the entire visual information. The drills are a little simple for them, but when you do it, when you can see only one half, one quarter, one eighth of the visual information, things are looking completely differently. And what happens eventually is that the ability to slow down the game for you when you take off the goal. Very hard to answer a 180 kilometers an hour serve when you can hardly see. Thank you. Now, can we really improve those skills? Eye reaction time. These graphs are from 18 athletes that went through a 12 sessions, 30 minutes each. They were in the lab, we tested their eye reaction time, they worked in the field, they came back to the lab after 12 sessions, and we've seen a 3.2% faster eye reaction time. What that means in tennis, for example, 3.2% are 22 milliseconds when you return a serve. Now, if you count, or if you look at the wrist motion, the angular velocity of the wrist is 1900 degrees per second. That equates to about 43%, it's 43 degrees extra. So you can put more spin on the ball. It changes the entire game when you just put your racket on the ball, or you can get a spin and move from defense to offense. In peripheral vision, we've seen an improvement for a score of 43 to 51 after 12 sessions. Anticipation, and I'm combining here our experience from our work and studies that have been in the literature. This is an anticipation study from Duke University that demonstrated that stroboscopic training can enhance anticipation. And perhaps what's most interesting, and from our experience, is that you can improve by about 8 to 10 percentile scores your perception span, the ability to see a large number of targets, your eye reaction time, your peripheral vision, but all those three are combined to make a huge difference in your decision making. Just think about it. If you can see events quicker, and if you can see more players or more targets, it helps you make better decisions. Accuracy. Again, it's a study from the literature that demonstrated that hockey is a very fast game, ice hockey, were able to improve their accuracy tasks by 18%. I've seen in shooting an improvement of 20%. There is a study in baseball that demonstrated an accuracy improvement by 14%. I think it all comes together to somewhere between 15 and 20%. What I think is happening is the following. You develop your eye reaction time, your peripheral vision, your eye-foot coordination. It helps you anticipate better for events on the field. When you anticipate better, you can actually put your body in a better posture. And when you are in a better posture, obviously your accuracy improves. That's the process that actually happens. I want to share with you four case studies. This is a top 10 tennis player that came to our lab at the end of 2015. He had a great serve, he has a great serve, poor return game, and he was injured a lot. He hired a sports doc and myself to help him get with an injury prevention program and with game vision, with one common goal: to work on his return game. Because if you're a couple of percentage points better than your opponent, but you are 15 percentage point lesser than your opponent on the return, you cannot compensate for that in your service game. These are his scores at the end of 2016. He really worked on his vision during training camps in Monte Carlo, in the US, in Israel, everywhere. And perhaps he improved in each and every aspect of his return game on a plus minus. Perhaps the most noticeable one was 26% more breakpoint opportunities compared to his second best year. He moved from top 15 to top 5. With the collective effort of the entire team, because the head coach was actually saying, we're gonna work this year on your return game, physically, vision, health-wise. This is another top 10 player. He came and had one of the best profiles in the lab. But his actual return game winning percentage was lower than what you would expect from someone that's in the 90th and above percentile in eye-hand coordination and decision-making. We filmed him with a fast-speed camera at 1,000 frames per second. And what we've noticed is that sometimes he's closing his eyes when he's hitting the ball. So he has great vision profile, but he's closing his eyes. We trained him with the strobe. He also came to our facility, and I think this year he's opening his eyes more, because he could have been a great soccer player too. He's a Chelsea fan. He's built greatly, but he should have a return game, as I said to his coach. He can be the next Andre Agassi. He shouldn't be where he is right now with his return game. So he's opening his eyes more, and he's getting very good results. On the other hand, this is a 17-year-old player that when she came, she had one of the poorest vision profiles that I've ever seen. That's the light green. She's powerful, she's tall, she has great technique, but she's slow for every return ball, especially on the right-hand side. I asked her coach, what do you do? And he said, I'm yelling at her, especially when she's missing on the right-hand side. I asked him, do you know that she can hardly see with her right eye? He said, no, I didn't know, I'm sorry. We took her to an optometrist, we got her contacts, we trained her reaction, and what you see here in dark green is the improvement after 6 months of vision correction and training. In general, everything that you see on the right-hand side, you can attribute to the new contacts, because those are, on the right-hand side, those are measures that you measure from a distance. On the left-hand side, those are close-range events like eye-hand coordination, decision-making, eye reaction time. Those are due to training. She jumped 140 spots in a period of 3 months. But, you know, this is really a very extreme case for a player that plays fast sports that can't see the ball, or can see the ball very poorly. And this is a realistic case. This is where we're heading now. Football academies. This is a 19-year-old academy player with decent scores that went through the program, and we can see exactly what I described earlier. Better eye reaction time, improvement, small improvement in eye reaction time, in peripheral vision, and big improvement in decision making. The gap between youth, between academies, and the top level game is widening because of the speed of the game. And we may lose young, talented athletes if we don't help them see clearer, decide faster, and react quicker, and get ready for the pace of the top level game. There are some global athletes, and that's actually an interesting story, because some global athletes, like Steph Curry, Larry Fitzgerald, have publicly endorsed this type of training. Others prefer to keep it for themselves, and that's okay. And there is a book that have been published recently that's talking about the growing awareness head in the game, and Ben's book, The Edge, that are bringing the awareness of training above the head. In summary, how fast do you see, how much do you see, how wide do you see can affect performance on the field in terms of the number of key passes per game that players are making, the passing accuracy, the number of chances converted, the anticipation and reaction and winning in 50-50 situations. Do we have a couple of minutes? All right, I need a volunteer. What's your name? Yaniv. Yaniv, you have a task. I'm gonna hold the ball here. Did you play football? A bit. Stand in front of me. I'll hold that ball here. You're gonna hold your hand about 10 to 15 centimeters above mine. I'll drop the ball, and you try to catch it in the air before it catches me. All right, five drives. One, two, it's close. Three, okay, one, hold on. No. The point is to try to train his eye reaction time in a demo. Put the glasses on. Take a look at the crowd. All right. Now I'm going to give you 10 trials. Just do me one favor. Don't run after the ball. Stay in place. I'll bring the ball, okay? 10 trials of training. Go for it, Yaniv. Very good. All right. It's getting better. But give me the 10. Place. All right, take off your glasses. Now the question is, are we getting anywhere? Five tries, okay? Like you did at the beginning, with eyes open. Come closer. Thanks for helping me with the demo. Participation. I really appreciate it. Thank you, Ben.
That was really great. And the demo at the end was super compelling. I feel like I've been playing tennis all my life wearing strobe glasses and not the real ones, so maybe I need some help as well. We do have time for questions. We're going to have a roving mic. So if you've got questions, and I'll ask Nick to come back as well. Nick, hi. Do you want to come back? So if anyone's got any questions for Nick Little-Hales, George and Don from SportMind or Erez, put your hand up and there'll be a mic coming over so we can find out a little bit more. Yes.
It's a quick question for Erez. How long, once someone's gone through the training process, how do you do any latency testing? So how long does the skill that we've just trained for, how long does that improved reaction time last for? Do you have to repeat the training, or is it a one-off, one-hit wonder?
This is one of the key questions that I was working on in the last 5 years, and this is the frequency and how many times you need to do it. The idea and the most efficient way is to build your abilities during preseason training, and then you need to practice only once or twice a week, about 20 minutes to maintain that. Now in tournament, sometimes in tennis, what we go through is you don't have the time to practice twice a week, but we go through a pre-game warm-up that lasts 5 minutes, but you do it every day.
Any other questions? If not, I've just got one before everyone goes. And it's about the transferability issue that Erez talked about and the application of all your tools, especially for academy players, because they are the future generation of talents. So I want to know, Nick, from you as well, are you working with academy players and is it easier or harder to get them to buy into all your tools?
Most of the work these days is with academy players. Yeah, that younger generation, started to millennial you all, or the world that they live in and breathe in, which I have no relationship with apparently. But they are where we get the new athletes from and the new players, and they're under demands which are, for some of us, not that recognisable and difficult to deal with. So we start to advise them in a negative way, like shut your tech down. And we don't really know what that means. Or blue light, their relationship with it, the fact that they live in a different world. So I work a lot with 16-year-olds, 14-year-olds, 17-year-olds, and I've currently got one now, and trying to protect them and get them from A to B every day with such the enormous amount of pressures. And there are lots of myths and misguided advice that confuses them and makes it worse. Just a lack of understanding, to be honest, Ben. A lack of understanding, sort of like, go to bed and I'll see you in the morning after good night's sleep, Well, a lot of the kids I work with, they want to be awake at 3 o'clock in the morning because they've got big games to play online with all their mates. This is how they've been brought up. I don't tell them to stop doing that, but if they have a couple of cycles, wake up, do what they need to do, get back and do another couple of cycles, catch up, zone out, they're smashing their world. But the parents are going, get to bed, shut your tech down, and do all of this sort of stuff without any knowledge of this natural process. So that's where I come in to sort of break down those barriers.
Is it the same issues for you guys as well?
Well, we're brand new. This is our launch in the UK, this is SoccerX. So we haven't... certainly not in this country. We haven't worked with academy players, but you can certainly see the benefits of how it would help them in the mindset. I said before, didn't I? How many young talented players are lost to football and to football clubs because of their mind rather than their physicality or their actual technical ability on a football pitch? There's way, way too many, and I believe this tool will definitely reduce those kind of numbers that are lost.
And I can add that in Slovakia. We are working just now with young and let's say the same age as you mentioned, because they saw it like a great support for these academy players, because today evening we can see the good generation from Slovakia players, but very clever people from association, they said, okay, but this is about support when they were 15, 16, 17. It's not about, this result is not about the current support. Yeah, so as much as possible, we are trying to support them in this age as well.
For Erez, I guess it's even more important to get them young, because if you're 28 and you're learning about your peripheral vision, it's almost too late.
Yes, I think that
I think that getting them young is, first, is the passion, and second is the ability to not lose talents, and third, I think that in today's professional game, coaches changes, and changes in general are so frequent that if you want to do something from the bottom up and build and see the results, academies is the right place to do it. And I also think that I enjoyed seeing all those completing technologies getting together and the general awareness for training above the neck. Thank you.
They are all complementary. So if you are working for clubs, I recommend all three expert practitioners, and your players, your athletes will get an edge. Thank you to Nick, to Erez, to Don, and to George as well. Thank you all for listening.